So, good evening, April 1, 2020, 9:43 p.m. Wednesday. So, discussion tayo sa module 2 ng auditing, sa auditing theory, which is audit planning, understanding the entity, and assessing risk. So, konting recap lang, ito ang mga audit, ito yung audit process. Now, PSA 300, planning an audit of financial statements. Now, anong scope nito? Well, accordingly, this PSA deals with the auditor's responsibility to plan an audit of financial statements. For added context lang, this is in connection with recurring audits, yung paulit-ulit, yung same lang auditor for several years. Additional requirements will be needed for initial audit engagement kung saan bago na yung auditor or kakasimula pa lang ng relationship. Basically, yung first-time audits. Now, ano ang role and timing of planning? Well, it involves establishing the overall audit strategy and developing an audit plan. So, basically, itong audit strategy, gaya na sabi ito, overall siya. Itong si audit plan, more specific ang kanyang nature. Now, nature and extent of planning activities will vary according to size and complexity of the entity, gaano ba to kalaki, conglomerate ba to, or sole proprietor, partnership ba? Or second, the key engagement team members, previous experience with the entity, so ito yung mga kasamahan mo, mga associates mo sa audit, mga colleagues mo, kung gaano ba sila ka-competent, kung ma-experience ba sila in regards sa kung ano yung business na ino-operate ng entity nyo. Third is changes in circumstances that occur during the audit. Siyempre, hindi naman yan masyadong consistent. Baka may mga biglang events na mangyayari. So, kailangan mapagplanuhan nyo na yan during the audit. Now, planning is a continual and iterative process that often begins shortly after or in connection with the completion of the previous audit and continues until the completion of the current audit. So, makikita nyo, halos walang pahinga. Kasi, kakatapos pa lang ng previous audit, kailangan mo nang paghandaan yung next audit. At matatapos lang siya kapag na-complete na ang current audit. So, halos walang pahinga. Now, continuing, auditor may decide to discuss elements of planning with the entity's management to facilitate the conduct and management of the audit engagement for proper coordination. Care is required in order not to compromise the effectiveness of the audit. Siyempre, yung management dapat aware siya sa kung ano yung gagawin mo. Kumbaga, sabihin mo, management, pinaplano ko sanang mag-inventory counting. Pinaplano ko sanang mag-cash counting. Pinaplano ko sanang i-check yung mga documents nyo. Siyempre, alam, para malaman ng management at hindi na sila magulat at ma-prepare nila yung documents. Pero, care is required in order to not compromise the effectiveness of the audit. Anong meaning yan? Ibig sabihin, hindi mo sila bibigyan ng specific details na kung anong gagawin mo. Bigyan mo lang sila ng general idea. Like, for example, sasabihin mo mag-inventory counting ka. Yun, ang management aware na mangyayari yun. So, pero hindi mo sasabihin kailan mo gagawin. Kumbaga, surprise. Same lang sa cash counting. Sasabihin mo, may plano ako mag-cash counting. Pero hindi mo sasabihin kailan mo gagawin. Para nandun yung element of surprise. Para hindi mo makompromise yung effectiveness ng audit. Kasi pag sabihin mong kailan mo gagawin, makakapag-prepare yung management. Lalo na kapag guilty sila of fraud. Makakapag-prepare sila na itago o i-conceal yung discrepancy or yung lapses. Now, objective. Ito sa planning and audit of financial statements. Anong objective niya? The objective of the auditor is to plan the audit so that it will be performed in an effective manner para efficient. Basic lang. Now, involvement of key engagement team members. Well, the engagement partner, ito yung mga partner sa mga audit firms, and other key members of the engagement team shall be involved in planning the audit, including planning and participating in the discussion among engagement team members. Siyempre, para may proper sa audit team nyo mismo, may proper coordination kayo kung ano yung gagawin nyo para smooth na lang ang operation. Now, preliminary engagement activity, ito yung mga gagawin nyo beforehand. The auditor shall undertake the following activities at the beginning of the current audit engagement. First is performing procedures required by PSA 220. Ano ba itong si PSA 220? Ito yung quality control on audit engagement. Now, regarding the continuance of the client relationship and the specific audit engagement. So basically, i-assess dito ni auditor kung nagko-comply ba sa quality control yung client para ma-make sure nila na maayos yung pagka-audit. Next is evaluating compliance with relevant ethical requirements including independence in accordance with PSA 220. Quality control pa rin. And ito, establishing an understanding of the terms of the engagement as required by PSA 210. Ito naman si PSA 210, ito yung agreeing on the terms of audit engagement. So basically, establishing an understanding of the terms of the engagement, ito, parang mas magiging clear both kay auditor and kay entity kung ano ba yung pagkakasunduan nila sa magiging audit engagement na mangyayari para may understanding sila para hindi magkaroon ng gulo or hindi sila magkagulo-gulo para on the same page sila kumbaga. Now, punta tayo sa planning activities. Well, accordingly, the auditor shall establish an overall audit strategy that sets a scope, timing and direction of the audit and that guides the development of the audit plan. So, gaya ng sabi ko kanina, itong audit strategy, overall yan siya. Kumbaga, in general, pagdating naman kay audit plan, ito more specific siya compared kay audit strategy. Now, in establishing the overall audit strategy, the auditor shall, first, identify the characteristics of the engagement that define its scope. So, second, ascertain the reporting objectives of the engagement plan to plan the timing of the audit and the nature of the communications required. Third, consider the factors that, in the auditor's professional judgment, are significant in directing the engagement team efforts. Fourth, consider the results of the preliminary engagement activities and, where applicable, whether knowledge. Nakat ko. And fifth, ascertain the nature, timing, extent of resource necessary to perform engagement. So basically, napaka in general in nature niya. Hindi siya nagbibigay ng specific. Ang sinasabi niya lang, ano ba ang dapat gawin sa audit? Hindi niya binibigay kung ano yung mga kailangan gawin. Ang sinasabi lang, ano yung mga dapat gawin. Kaya nga, overall audit strategy. Understandable naman ang mga terms na ginamit dito. Now, continuing, the auditor shall develop. Ito naman si audit plan, yung mas specific. Shall include the description of the nature, timing, extent of planned risk assessment procedure. Kita nyo? Planned risk assessment procedures. Napunta ka na sa procedures. Yung mga specific mong gagawin as determined by PSA 3.5. The nature, timing, extent of planned further audit procedures at the assessment level as determined by PSA 3.30. And other planned audit procedures that are required to be carried out so that the engagement complies with the Philippine Standards on Auditing. Kita nyo? Ito, napaka in general ng gusto niyang gawin. Pagdating kay audit plan, napaka specific. I-laid out mo na kung ano yung mga dapat mong yung mga kailangan mong gawin. Yung mga specific procedures na kailangan mong i-comply. Now, ito naman, the establishment of the overall audit strategy and the detailed audit plan are not necessarily discrete or sequential process, but are closely interrelated since changes in one may result in consequential changes to the other. Now, continuing, changes to planning decisions during the course of the audit, anong mangyayari or anong gagawin? Well, ang sabi, the auditor shall update and change the overall audit strategy and the audit plan as necessary during the course of the engagement. Siyempre, hindi ka dapat maging concrete. Dapat flexible ka kasi may mga times talaga na may magbabago or may mga developing events na kung saan bigla lang mangyayari. That in your assessment will affect the audit. Will affect yung gagawin mong audit. So, because of that, kailangan mong i-update and change yung overall audit strategy, yung audit plan, para ma-adjust mo or maayon mo, magkaroon ka ng, ano tawag nun? Ma-adapt mo yung adaptability mo para yung audit na gagawin mo, proper. Second, as a result of unexpected events, changes in conditions or the audit evidence obtained from the results of audit procedures, the auditor may need to modify the overall audit strategy and audit plan. So ito, hindi lang basta-basta concrete na yung gagawin mong planning. Siyempre, dapat maging flexible ka rin kasi may mga developing events yan na mangyayari na kung saan it will really affect your audit engagement. So, dapat flexible tayo, class. Now, dito naman tayo sa direction, supervision, and review. Now, accordingly, the auditor shall plan the nature, timing, and extent of direction and supervision of engagement team members and the review of their work. The nature, timing, and extent of the direction and supervision of engagement team members and review of their work vary depending on many factors. So, basically, ang sinasabi lang dito, kailangan sa team nyo pa lang mismo, maayos na ang pagkaplano nyo. Bakit? Para efficient yung magiging execution nyo ng audit engagement. Para walang gulo-gulo. Now, additional consideration. Ito, di ba? Ang sabi dito sa planning, pagdating sa initial, sa recurring audit engagement, pati sa initial audit engagement, medyo pareho yan sila. Pero nagkakaroon na ng difference kasi sa initial audit engagement, may additional considerations ka on top of what was required na pareho sa initial pati recurring. Ano itong mga additional considerations para kay initial audit engagement? Well, first, the auditor shall undertake the following activities prior to starting an initial audit. First, performing procedures required by PSA 220. Ano nga yung PSA 220? Ito yung quality control on audit engagement. Regarding the acceptance of the client relationship and the specific audit engagement. Second, communicating with the predecessor auditor, if meron. Kasi minsan yung class, kasi pagkakaalala ko, every 5 years dapat nagpapalit ng auditor. Ewan ko kung 5 years pa rin, pero meron talaga yung required na every 5 or 7 years, dapat nagpapalit ng auditor. So, may chance talaga yan na magkakaroon ng predecessor auditor. Pero may mga engagement rin na first time audit ng company, lalo na yung mga bagong company. So, yun, wala yung predecessor auditor. Pero pag may predecessor auditor, yung previous auditor, kailangan magkaroon ng communication para malaman mo if there have been any change or where there has been change in compliance with relevant ethical requirements. So, kailangan mo makipag-communicate kung merong predecessor auditor. Now, dito, the purpose and objective of planning the audit are the same whether the audit is an initial or recurring engagement. However, gaya na sabi ko, for an initial audit, the auditor may need to expand the planning activities because the auditor does not ordinarily have the previous experience with the entity that is considered when planning recurring engagement. Kasi, parang ano, kung i-compare pa yan sa life relationship natin, kumbaga, nakita, nagkaroon ka ng crush, niligawan mo. Anong tawag doon? Initial audit engagement, kumbaga. Pero kapag yung naging shota mo is kaibigan mo na dati, ibig sabihin may idea ka na about sa kanyang pag-ugali. So, kung i-connect yun natin dito, it is a recurring engagement kasi may previous knowledge or previous experience ka na sa taong yun. Pero kapag yung shota mo, hindi mo kaibigan dati, niligawan mo lang agad, tapos sinagot ka, wala kang previous experience regarding sa kanya. So, ano yun siya? Initial audit engagement. So, mas delikado ang initial audit engagement kasi wala kang previous knowledge, wala kang previous experience. So, kailangan to assess that or to cope with that lapses or discrepancy, kailangan mo mag-expand ng planning activities mo para mas magkaroon ka ng idea about that audit engagement or about that entity. Now, ito, continuation ng additional consideration. For an initial audit engagement, additional matters that auditor may consider in establishing the overall audit strategy and audit plan include the following. Review the predecessor's auditor's working papers kapag mayroong predecessor auditor unless prohibited by law or regulation. Now, paano naman kapag si entity mismo, sabi niya, hoy, auditor, wag kang magkipag-communicate sa predecessor auditor. Anong tawag doon? It is a scope limitation. So, it will affect your audit opinion it will affect your audit opinion. Kasi, kapag pre-event ka ni management without any justifiable reason kung bakit bawal ka makipag-communicate sa predecessor auditor, tawag dyan scope limitation, which will affect your audit opinion. Now, dito naman, any major issues to be discussed with management and those in charge with governance, yun, kapag may major issues, the audit procedure necessary to obtain sufficient appropriate evidence, so audit evidence, regarding opening balances, ito yung mga sa beginning balances o yung starting balances ng fiscal or accounting period. Siyempre, since initial audit engagement ka, wala kang idea anong nangyari, paano nakuha yung opening balances. Kasi, first time audit mo yan, first time mong makikita yung book. So, para magkaroon ka ng idea regarding sa opening balances na yan, kailangan mo mag-perform ng additional audit procedures necessary to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence regarding opening balances para, gaya na sabi ko, magkaroon ka ng idea about this. And ito, other procedures required by the firm's system of quality control for initial audit engagement. Now, punta naman tayo kay PSA 315, which is identifying and assessing the risk of material misstatements through understanding the entity and its environment. So, kung maalala natin ano ang risk of material misstatements, ito yung inherent risk and control risk. Inherent risk, ano yun? Ito yung risk sa company kung saan wala pang implemented internal controls. Ano naman ang control risk? Ito yung after mong in-implement ang internal controls, may natira pa ring risk. Kasi, wala talagang chance na magiging zero ang risk. It's virtually impossible. So, anong risk of material misstatement ulit? Ito si inherent, pati si control risk. Now, ano ang scope ni PSA 315? Well, it deals with the auditor's responsibility to identify and assess the risk of material misstatements in the financial statements through understanding the entity and its environment including the entity's internal control. So, makita natin dito, para ma-identify mo ang risk or ma-assess mo ang risk, kailangan may understanding ka about sa entity. Basic, di ba? No brainer. Paano naman pagdating sa objective? Well, accordingly, the objective of the auditor is to identify and assess the risk of material misstatement, whether due to fraud or error, at the financial statement and assertion levels. Tingnan nyo, at the financial statement and assertion levels. So, through understanding the entity and its environment, including the entity's internal control, thereby providing a basis for designing and implementing responses to the assess risk of material misstatement. Ang haba, di ba? Basta ang point lang yan, dapat si auditor magkaroon siya ng planning or dapat maging goal niya is to be able to identify and assess the risk of material misstatement sa financial statement and assertion levels ng company para makapag-provide siya ng responses to counter that assess of risk material misstatement para ma-counter yun para hindi maka-affect masyado sa audit engagement or ma-properly magawa or ma-execute yung audit engagement. Now, mahaba to sila, mga, pero side notes lang to siya para sa definition of terms. Now, ano ba si assertions? Kanina pa natin sinasabi si assertions. Well, accordingly, assertions are representations by management, explicit or otherwise, that are embodied in the financial statements as used by the auditor to consider the different types of potential misstatements that may occur. So, ito yung mga, kung maalala nyo pa, ito yung mga completeness, occurrence, pero yun, sila, don't worry kasi bibigyan natin yung list nila mamaya. Now, si business risk naman, a risk resulting from significant conditions, events, circumstances, actions, or inactions that could adversely affect an entity's ability to achieve its objective and execute its strategies, or from the setting of inappropriate objectives and strategies. So, ito yung basically yung mga risks na which was a result of such event or circumstances na kung i-assess natin would have an adverse effect or would harm the entity's ability to achieve its objective. Basically, those that will affect its operations. Yun si business risk. Now, ano naman si internal control? Well, the process designed, implemented, and maintained by those charged with governance, management, and other persons to provide reasonable assurance about the achievement of an entity's objectives with regard to reliability of financial reporting, effectiveness, and efficiency of operations, and compliance with applicable laws and regulations. Basically, ito yung controls na sinet ng company pala, yung mga assertions nila, yung mga financial statements nila, yung operations nila will be reliable and efficient sa operation, and to make sure that they are properly complying with applicable laws and regulations. Internal control, meaning, ito yung move na ginawa ni entity to make sure na everything is properly done, to make sure that everything is properly operating efficiently, to make sure that everything or that the company is properly complying with the necessary laws and regulations that it is under jurisdiction to follow. Now, risk assessment procedures. Ano to siya? Well, ito yung mga audit procedures performed to obtain an understanding of the entity and its environment, including the entity's internal control, to identify and assess the risk of material statement, whether due to fraud or error at the financial statement and assertion levels. And lastly, si significant risk, unidentified and assessed risk of material misstatement that in the auditor's judgment requires special audit consideration. For example, sabi na natin yung company, marami siyang financial instruments under IFRS 9 kung saan yung valuation niya is very complex. Now, in the professional judgment of the auditor, this transaction or this account needs a special audit consideration given the fact that the financial instruments under that IFRS 9 kung saan yung valuation nila is very complex to determine. So kailangan to make sure that proper yung naging valuation nila, a special audit consideration will be considered or will be complied para to make sure na proper yung valuation sa financial instruments na yun. Now, risk assessment procedures and related activities. Na ano to? Well, accordingly, the auditor shall perform risk assessment procedures to provide a basis for the identification and assessment of risk of material misstatements at the financial and financial statement and assertion levels. But by themselves, do not provide sufficient appropriate audit evidence on which to base the audit opinions. Kasi kung matatandaan nyo, si Riz, sa initial audit engagement, nandyan si, ipe-perform natin ang mga risk assessment procedures. Then, kapag, sa planning pa lang yan, di ba? Then, kapag, yung sa audit planning pa lang, ipe-perform na natin si risk assessment procedures. Pero pagdating sa actual audit, kung matatandaan natin, sa actual audit, yung pi-perform mo na yung audit engagement, ang ginagawa na natin is, konting ano lang, recap lang, is test of controls and substantive procedures. So, tatandaan nyo, sa audit planning, diyan natin pina-perform series assessment procedure, pero pagdating sa actual, or dun sa proper audit, diyan na papasok sina test of controls, pati si substantive procedures. Kaya nakalagay dito, but by themselves, do not provide sufficient appropriate audit evidence on which to base the audit opinion. Bakit? Kasi itong si risk assessment procedure, ang purpose niya lang is to give the auditor an idea about the operations of the entity, about the characteristics of the entity, about the nature of the entity, about the nature of its operations. Yun lang yung purpose ni risk assessment procedures, para si auditor magka-idea ano ba tong pinagagawa ni entity. Kaya kung makikita niyo dito, yung risk assessment procedures shall include the following: inquiry, ano sa, magtanong-tanong ka. Analytical procedures, ito yung magko-compare-compare ka ng mga datas, ng mga accounts, ng mga numbers. And observation and inspection. Wala pa dito yung ibang kailangan mong gawin. Kasi nga, nag-a-assess ka pa lang ng risk. Hindi mo pa pine-perform si actual audit. Nag-a-assess ka pa lang ng risk. Nagkakalap ka pa lang ng idea about sa operations ni company. Tandaan nyo yan, ha? Now, understanding the entity and its environment including its internal control. So the entity and its environment. So kailangan magkaroon tayo ng understanding about sa industry and regulations. For example, saan siya? Sa banking ba siya? So anong mga regulations na under sa kanya? Banking laws, PIDC, SEC, yung mga memorandum ng BSP. So, yun, pag-under sa banking, yung industry niya. Second, nature of the entity. Ano bang operations ito? Siyempre, financial, ownership. Ano ba ito? Board of directors, sino-sinong may-ari. And governance, accounting policy. O, yung mga ginagamit sa banking. Objectives, or yung sa GAAP, PFRS. PAS, IFRS, IAS, yun. Objectives and strategies. Measurement and review of the entity's financial performance, lalo na sa banking. Oh, sample lang yun, pag banking. Next is entity's internal control. Obtain an understanding of internal control relevant to the audit. Siyempre, yung mga internal controls lang na makakatulong sa pag-audit mo. Wala ka ng paki dun sa mga internal controls na wala naman labot sa audit engagement. Bakit? Kasi waste of time and resources lang yun. Dapat mag-focus ka sa mga internal control na may effect or makaka-affect sa audit engagement. Next is evaluate the design of those controls and determine whether they have been implemented. So make sure na yung mga controls na yun is make sure kung to know kung na-implement ba yung mga internal controls na yun. Bakit? Kasi it will affect your risk assessment. Let's say na hindi na-implement yung controls na yun, o sa risk assessment mo, masasabi mo na mataas ang risk. Pero pag nakita mo na properly implemented yung controls na yun, masasabi mo sa risk assessment pa lang na relatively mababa yung risk. Bakit? Anong importance ito? Kasi there pa lang, it will affect your actual audit engagement, yung audit proper, yung gagawin mo na yung actual procedures na test of controls and substantive procedures. Kasi from there pa lang, pag na-assess mo na maganda yung controls, yung mga future na gagawin mo, mas mababa. Or not mas konti na lang ang mga procedures na kailangan mong gawin kasi nakita mo na yung controls ng company maayos naman pala. Now, ano bang components ng internal control? Well, first is the control environment. Ano to? Includes the governance and management functions and the attitudes, awareness, and actions of those charged with governance and management concerning the entity's internal control and its importance in the entity. It's important since it sets the tone of an organization, influencing the control consciousness of its people. So basically, ano ba itong si control environment? Well, accordingly, it is basically the atmosphere within the entity. Kung ano ba yung atmosphere na sinet ng management or ng governance or ng those in charge with governance in regards to the operations of the entity. Kapag yung si management and those in charge with governance, sinet nila yung atmosphere na kung saan dapat proper yung control procedures na pinagagawa, na lahat chine-check, na lahat mini-make sure na proper and efficient yung operations ng company. Siyempre, ang mangyayari yan is it will influence the control consciousness of the people. Ang isipin ng mga tao, oh, hindi ako pwede magloko dito. Kasi si management, kasi those in charge with government, seryoso sa pag-implement ng internal control. Pero kapag the opposite ang nangyari, hindi nag-set ng proper tone si management or those in charge of governance in relation to the internal controls of the company, ang iisipin ng mga trabahador, ang iisipin ng mga employee, uy, parang pwede ako magloko dito kasi itong si management parang walang pake sa internal control ng management. So, mahalaga na yung control environment ng company, ng entity, is properly set ng management para it will deter any kalokohan on the side of the employees or the management themselves. Second, the entity's risk assessment procedure or process. It forms the basis for how management determines the risk to be managed. If that process is appropriate to the circumstances, including the nature, size, and complexity of the entity, it assists the auditor in identifying risk of material misstatement. So, dito, hindi lang si auditor ang nagpe-perform ng risk assessment. Pati yung entity mismo, nagpe-perform sila ng sarili ng risk assessment. Na itong si auditor, titingnan yung paano ini-implement ng entity yung risk assessment, yung sarili nilang risk assessment. Pag nag-determine yung auditor na, uy, maayos naman pala sila mag-risk assessment, kukuha ko ng idea. Gagamitin ko ito to help me assist in the risk assessment for material misstatement sa to help me assist in my own risk assessment. Pero kapag pangit naman tong, pero on the other hand, kapag pangit yung risk assessment ni entity, isipin ni auditor, oy, parang wala mang tong paki si entity sa sarili niyang operations kasi hindi siya proper mag-implement ng risk assessment. So anong isipin ni auditor? Ah, parang may problema dito or incompetent lang yung entity. So mahalagang to check the entity's risk assessment process. Now, the information system including the related business processes relevant to financial reporting and communication. Anong kailangan gawin ni auditor? Well, the auditor needs to understand such as it influences how the company reports. Siyempre ngayon, modern na tayo. Marami ng companies ang automated. So since automated yan, kailangan si auditor magkaroon siya ng understanding how that automation affects the reporting of the company. Siyempre, kapag yung company manual pa rin, i-assess rin niya ni auditor on how that manual system affects the reporting of the entity. Efficient ba? Tama-tama ba? Proper bang estimation nila? May mga discrepancies ba? May mga lapses? So, mahalaga yan, i-assess ni auditor yung information system ng company. Fourth, components of internal control. Fourth is control activities relevant to the audit. So, gaya ng sabi ko, these are policies procedures that help ensure the management directives are carried out. Pero yung mga controls lang na i-assess mo is yung may connection sa audit mo. Wala ka na labot or wala ka ng pake dun sa mga walang connection or hindi makaka-affect sa audit mo para you will not waste time and resources. Lastly, monitoring of controls, a process to assess the effectiveness of internal control performance over time. Management accomplishes monitoring of controls through ongoing activities, separate evaluation or a combination of two. So ito, titingnan ni auditor. O, si management, nag-implement siya ng internal controls. Pero ito bang si management, minomonitor niya kung yung controls na in-implement niya is properly followed. So, doon titingnan ni auditor, chine-check naman ni management na na properly operating ang internal control niya. So, makikita ni auditor na less yung risk. Pero kapag nakita ni auditor na hindi properly pina-follow ni entity yung monitoring ng controls niya, doon tataas ang risk. So, basically, itong limang to, it helps the auditor to, in looking, in assessing the internal control of the management. Kasi from there, makakatulong yan sa auditor to assess how much risk is there in the company. Kasi pag pangit ang internal control, mataas ang risk. Kapag mababa ang, kapag maayos ang internal control, relatively, mababa ang risk. So, yun yung purpose nun. So, ito naman, identifying and assessing risk of material misstatement. The auditor shall identify and assess the risk of material misstatement. Anong risk of material misstatement? Ito yung inherent pati control risk. At the financial level, financial statement level. Ito yung FS ng company. And second, the assertion level. For classes of transaction, account balances, and disclosure. So, basically, ito parang overall. Itong assertion level parang more specific, particularly sa classes of transaction, account balances, and disclosures. Now, with this in the financial statement and assertion levels, anong gagawin ni auditor? First, is to identify the risk. Second, assess the identified risk. Third, relate the identified risk to what can go wrong at the assertion level. Fourth is consider the likelihood of misstatement. So, alamin ko anong risk. I-assess mo kung ano yung risk na yon, i-relate mo, tingnan mo kung anong mangyayari kapag yung risk na yon nagkaroon ng effect sa management or sa basically titingnan mo ano yung magiging possible effects ng risk na yon, ano yung magiging adverse effect niya sa company. After knowing that, tingnan mo, consider the likelihood of the misstatement. Ano yung probability or ano yung probability na kung saan yung risk na yon will cause a misstatement to the company. Like for example, remote lang ba yung probability? Possible lang ba? Or probable or absolute na magkakaroon ng misstatement. So yun, consider the likelihood. Now, continuing, identifying the assessing the risk of material statement. Risk that requires special, ito na, yung sinasabi kanina, special audit consideration. Significant risk often relate to significant non-routine transactions or judgmental matters. Ano mga non-routine transactions? Well, ito yung mga transactions that are unusual due to either size of nature and that therefore occur infrequently. Ano magandang example nito? Well, let's say yung sardines company. Well, anong operations nila? Na nagpo-produce or nagma-manufacture sila ng sardines products. Now, itong si sardines company, biglang bumili ng several properties. Real properties, mga lupa. Now, anong tawag dun? Mga non-routine transaction. Bakit itong si sardines company, ang routine transaction niya is to produce or manufacture sardines, hindi ang bumili ng real estate properties. So, because of that non-routine transaction, may significant risk which will require a special audit consideration. Now, kapag sa second naman is yung judgmental matters, kung saan may include the development of accounting estimates for which there is significant measurement uncertainty. Dito naman kay judgmental matters, it talks about more on the estimate, accounting estimates. Ano magandang example niyan? Yung financial instruments sa IFRS 9. Bakit? Kasi yung mga financial instruments sa IFRS 9, valuation lang, yung valuation nila is based on accounting estimates naman. Kasi, naka-base sa market, usually, ang valuation nila or sa ano yung fair value nila, yung ibang financial instruments. So, because of that, since estimates halos talaga siya, there's room for error or mistake or even fraud. Kaya, based on judgmental matters, kailangan magkaroon ng special audit consideration because of the existence of a significant risk. Now, dito naman tayo sa risk for which substantive procedures alone do not provide sufficient appropriate audit evidence. Kung matatandaan natin, pagdating sa audit proper, ang ginagawa na is test of controls and substantive procedures. Na paano pag substantive procedures? And may mga times din kasi na pwede lang na substantive procedures lang ang pwede mong gawin. Na yung test of controls, pwede mo nang baliwalain. Pero, may mga times rin na kung saan si substantive procedures mismo is not enough to provide a sufficient appropriate audit evidence. So, kapag gano'n yung nangyari, there will be times that the substantive procedures are not enough. So, to aid the auditor, the entity's control will be relevant to gain more understanding. Ito na yung test of controls. Or yung kahit sa risk assessment procedures pa lang. Kapag si substantive procedures ay hindi enough. So, revision of risk assessment. Risk assessment may change throughout the audit as more evidence are gathered. So, 40 minutes na. Part 2 coming.